हेलो हेलो
हाय हेलो
या सर, फॉर अ मिनट कैन यू स्टॉप शेयरिंग
डॉक्टर.
योर स्क्रीन?
ओके
या यस, थैंक यू सो मच. जस्ट 1 मिनट. सो आई थिंक वी हैव डॉक्टर जयंती मानी इन. नो नॉट येट.
She has not joined.
Let me give her a call and come back. हेलो.
हेलो.
आई हैव स्पोकन टू डॉक्टर जयंती मणि, बट शी सेज शी इज लॉग्ड इन, बट आई कांट सी हर इन द अटेंडीज. सो शी इज ट्राइंग टू री लॉग इन. सो आई थिंक वी विल हैव टू वेट अ लिटिल मोर टाइम. सर,
और आफ्टर टू जॉइन लाइक शी ट्राइड विद द लास्ट लिंक ओनली द नेम विल बी डिस्प्लेड ऑफ माइन.
या लेट्स सी नाउ इफ
कैन
शी
चेंज दैट ऑन स्क्रीन और इट्स नॉट दैट पॉसिबल.
I don't think when you get the email, it gives you an option to change the name. 1 second, she's calling me. Hello.
She can hear me, but
Yeah, you can do that. So we have Dr. Mani in now. Hello.
Yeah, now she has joined.
Yeah. So now you can start sharing your screen, and if you want to move ahead with the meeting, or do we want to wait for somebody else?
No, I think it's already 5 o'clock.
Yes, it's five.
Five, yes. Five. So
let's start. Yeah.
Okay.
So good afternoon, everyone. After the last yesterday's two lectures, we are moving on to next two lectures, which are scheduled today. The first one will be Technicals and Artifacts in EEG by me, and then Abnormal EEG, Focal and Generalized, both will be covered by Dr. Jayanti Mani. So I'll introduce Dr. Jayanti Mani first. She's a consultant neurologist and epileptologist at Kokilaben Dhirubhai Ambani Hospital. She's also attached to Lokmanya Tilak Hospital as honorary consultant. She had her postgraduate training and DM neurology from KEM Hospital and St. G.S. Medical College, Mumbai. She did her 2 years fellowship from prestigious Cleveland Clinic, USA, with Dr. Hans Luders. Her special interest is complex epilepsy and EEG and epilepsy surgery. She has many publications, more than 50 in national and international journals, few book chapters and invited reviews. She's member, she has membership for Joint Secretary, Indian Epilepsy Association, Mumbai chapter, member of ILAE, Task Force on EEG, and member of AN, AES, and IAN. Then I have to introduce myself. I am Dr. Anand Diwan, practicing neurologist at Nasik, attached to Shriya's Hospital, Sayad Hospital, and I have my own OPD setup, clinical setup. I am also attached to medical college in Nasik. I have done my DNB neurology from Jaslok Hospital and Research Center. I did my MRC PUK neurology specialty certification examination in 2014. I did diploma in European Board of Neurology. I have short training in epilepsy at Cleveland Clinic. I am member and international diplomat of American Board of Clinical Neurophysiology and Epilepsy Monitoring. Also international diplomat in American Board of Electrodiagnostic Medicine. I also presented posters and papers at various national and international conferences. Am I audible and clear?
Yeah.
So moving on to the first topic of today's, that's the technicals and artifacts, how to record a good EEG.
Someone is saying your voice is not clear. Sorry, Anand. Someone has messaged.
Okay.
I think it's sometimes dragging a bit. I don't know if it's better now, because there are some messages saying that you're not audible.
Okay. Am I audible now?
I can hear you.
Yes. So actually, I think there's an issue with the internet connectivity, your internet connectivity.
Okay, my volume is low, your voice is clear. That's what we... Okay. So protocol for routine EEG and recording. Is it okay now?
They say better, but not still clear.
Ma'am, I can hear his voice.
Okay, no, I'm just looking at the comments that are coming in.
I'll try to be louder again. So routine EEG protocol, we ask ideally the patient should sleep less, maybe just 4 to 5 hours before the previous, before the EEG on the previous night. The recording has to be at least 20 minutes of awake and sleep both, so at least 40 minutes. We try to obtain a natural sleep, but sometimes may require sedatives, especially in a pediatric population. Steps for recording, we check calibration, we check filters, we check impedance of all electrodes, record the background activity, check reactivity, whether eyes open, close, what is response to mental arithmetic, how is the response to sleep.
Sorry, Anand, are you sharing your screen?
Yeah, that is exactly what I wanted to say.
not shared?
No.
Sorry.
We stopped sharing your screen.
Now?
Yes. Full screen karna. Huh? Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. And we check these activation procedures like photic stimulation, hyperventilation, photosensitivity. We try to identify and remove artifacts as much as possible. And the technician, or if you are there, we should be always alert to detect electrographic seizures and record patient's response during that abnormal electrical discharge. So what's the calibration? So calibration is just checking the machine, whether it is functioning well or not. We have two types of calibration. One is mechanical and second is biocalibration. Mechanical is just to see how the pens or the channels are moving to square wave potentials. And biocalibration is how the channels or pen respond to the potential which are generated by the brain. Usually we try to get the potential across farthest distance on the skull, that's diagonally opposite, usually FP2 and O1 or FP1, O2. The next slide shows what is the mechanical and biocalibration. Many say that this is required only for analog machines, the required. Because in the first half of slide where the mechanical calibration is being done, we know that the channels, many channels are looking alike, but if you look at 2, 4, 7, and 10, the potential generated here are little different than the other ones. Here it is little blunted compared to channel 1. Can you see my pointer? In channel 4, the potential is very sharp up and sharp down. So very steep rise and steep fall. For 7, fall is very slow. And this is because there are some changes in the filters. Here the high frequency filter is set at 15. That's why it is blunted. Here the low filter or time constant is 0.03, which is like a 5 hertz, which is more than what is ideal required. So that's why the slow wave is not generated. While when the time constant is reduced or low filter is also reduced, we have a prolonged decay, or the slow wave will be prolonged. This is how reflected in the biocalibration. When FP1 O2 potential is passed through all the channels simultaneously, for channel 2, this is little blunted. In fact, all the electrodes are showing electrical interference, which is not seen here. Okay, that's because 15 hertz, and also it has become little blunted. For channel 4, when the decay is less, the amplitude is reduced. While when the low filter is less than what is required, the slow wave component is prolonged, and we see a bigger wave compared to the other normal waves. And when the sensitivity is low, with sensitivity is high, it is again, amplitude is reduced. So when you look at this mechanical and biocalibration, immediately we'll come to know that some channels or some electrodes, the electrode channels are not functioning properly. And our aim is to correct those before we proceed with the recording. Now, once it is corrected in channels 2, 4, 7, 10, now all look similar. All the biocalibrations is also exactly similar in all electrodes. The filter settings for routine, we do 1 hertz low filter and 70 hertz as a high filter. Always try to use the appropriate filters. Change only if needed. Usually try to avoid change in filter settings. Use the amplitude, change the amplitude, or even can cause a phase shift. Reduce high frequency filter from 70 to 35 if muscle artifact is predominant and obscuring EEG. And when we are doing that, trust only the slow activity. Okay, don't rely on the fast activity when you are reducing the high frequency filter. Similarly, if there are excess slow waves because of sweat artifacts, try to increase low frequency filter to the from 1 to 5 hertz, and then here you try to focus only on fast activity and don't try to inference from the slow waves or the waves which have prolonged duration. Somebody yesterday asked what is the time constant. It is the decay in percent with the time. So we usually keep it 1.6 seconds, 0.1 hertz, or sorry, 1 hertz, 0.16 seconds, that's here. So this is standard setting for the low pass filter. The filters are not accurately functioning most of the times, or whatever the filters we have, even if it's a 1 hertz filter, it will not just cut all waves which are less than 1 hertz. It will still pass few waves lesser than 1 hertz, and while doing so, they will try to reduce the amplitude. So the waves which are less than 1 hertz, the amplitude reduces 70%. When it is 0.5 hertz, which are passed through 1 hertz filter, the amplitude reduces 25, and so on. So this is ideal filter, but we don't have ideal filters. So this is the result we get when the waves pass through this filter, which are lesser in frequency than the set filter. Now here, the high frequency filter is change from 70 to 35 because this muscle artifact is seen here. And now we can see this muscle artifact we have reduced. But at the same time, we see some fast activity here, but we should not rely or should not try to make anything out of these fast waves because we have reduced the fast filters. Here you can still rely on the slow waves because those are unchanged. Similarly, to reduce sweat artifacts, when it is excess slow movements, we try to increase the low frequency filter from 1 hertz to 5 hertz. And then this low wave artifact is reduced. Another artifact which is filtering only 50 hertz. So this electrical interference, which is 50 hertz in our part, is reduced if we just apply the electrode, the filter, which is 50 hertz. So to record EEG, always it's a systematic and multiple stages of preparation. Recording parameters must be set correctly. All the filter settings, sensitivities, impedance, everything has to be checked, because any mistake or omission while preparing for EEG may lead to serious errors in interpretation. We have to be thoroughly preparing for the EEG with the settings, and then only we can interpret the EEG once it is recorded. So here are a few examples. This EEG looks showing some electrical interference here. You cannot really make out the background activity. Why so? Because it is still open wires, it is still not connected to the patient, and still it will show this kind of record. So always make sure that the input cable is securely connected to the EEG instrument and also the EEG wires to the patients. This slide shows some fast spiky activity followed by generalized slowing. To unexperienced eye, it may look like a generalized seizure disorder followed by slowing, but this is nothing but just the movement related artifact. The wires are moving, and that's why this seizure-like activity is recorded. Also, try to look whether each electrode correctly placed in the designated side of the headboard. We know that here is some eye blink artifact, but here in channel 1 and channel 2, it looks a little funny. The FP2 F4 shows the down wave here, but here we are seeing some up wave and then down wave, which should not be there. It is out of phase. This is because the FP1 F3 electrodes have been switched. The electrode which should go into F3 socket is placed in FP1, and the electrode which go in FP1 was placed in F3. So this is the result, and then we have difficulty in interpreting what is happening.
Similarly, see whether all the filters and sensitivity is equal for all the electrode channels, because sometimes it may happen that one channel is the sensitivity has been changed. Usually we do it for the EKG channel, but for mistakenly sometimes the filter settings or the sensitivity might get changed, and then it's difficult to interpret. Here, the when we see the C3P3P3O1, that left centrum parietal, compared to the right centrum parietal, it looks very attenuated. We may comment as this is there is asymmetry, but once the sensitivity from 10 increase, the sensitivity is reduced to 7 or gain is increased, you see the homologous area equal. So this was technical error and not the true error. Similarly, impedance has to be sufficiently low, because sometimes here the O1 electrode is not properly attached to the skin. The impedance is high. That's why it is picking the ground or the electrical interference. And also at the same time, you can must have noticed the EKG artifact is also picked up. So impedance has to be correctly checked, and each and every electrode should have more than 100 ohms or less than 5 kilo ohms. Again, the montages which are programmed are correct. Usually, this error will not happen once for the first time we have corrected the montages, because after that F3 is not followed by F3 C3, but here it is C3 F3. That's why it is showing the error. Sorry. Is the sweep speed appropriate? Because sometimes the change in paper speed also changes the each waveforms. Here the EG looks more compact. It is slow speed, 15 seconds per page. When you correct it to 10 seconds per page, you see the EG in better. Is filter setting appropriate? Here we see the filter setting. The high filter is set at 15, low at 0.1 time constant, that's 1.6. So sensitivity, the frequency, the high filter is not correct. It is 15. It should be ideally 70 or more. Here we are seeing some fast beta, focal beta activity, but ideally it is to be seen with the 70 hertz filter, and then we can very well say it is not abnormal, but it is nothing but a muscle artifact. So setting of filters is very important. Low frequency settings, again the EEG which was presented here is with a 5 hertz filter. Here we see everything as if normal, because the filter setting is not correct. We have missed the slowing, which was definitely seen if we lower the low frequency filter, that's to 1 hertz. So this is not correct. Usually our technicians, few are smart and few are over smart, try to give us a very clean looking EEG page. So they will try to reduce the high frequency filter from 70 to 35 or even 15. They will raise the low frequency filter from 1 to 5 and try to give us this good looking page where we hardly see any artifacts, any abnormality, and then we pass it as a normal. But with the proper settings, with proper sensitivity, I think the abnormality will be picked up very well, like here. Again, the sensitivity, when the potentials are very big, large, then it's difficult to make out what is happening here. But once you reduce the sensitivity or the increase the sensitivity or reduce the gain, you will see that this is nothing but the muscle artifact. It's bond. The voice is audible.
Yes.
Montage selection and change appropriate. Here in a longitudinal bipolar montage, most of the times we just screen the EEG in one montage, usually longitudinal bipolar, and may not find any abnormality. But usually it's better to counter check with some other montage, usually transverse or sometimes common average montage. Hello? And then sometimes the few abnormalities will be picked up.
Hello.
Hello. Who's this?
Hello. Hello.
Next, whether the electrodes are placed with the accurate measurements. So here you can see the C3P3 channel showing the amplitude which is less or asymmetrically low compared to 4 compared to 5. So there is no abnormality. True abnormality where you can get an amplitude which is less in one channel and more in the another channel compared to the homologous part on the opposite side. But the error was the P3 electrode was nearer to C3. That's why the distance between C3 P3 was low and the amplitude was low, and the distance between P3 and O1 was more than normal, and so the amplitude was high. So once that P3 was moved to O1, the both channels are looking okay and comparable to the opposite side. So taking accurate measurements before placing the electrodes for 1020 system is very important, because that may falsely give us the voltage asymmetry on the while reporting the EEG. So simple rules for EEG recording with all the technicals and artifacts in mind. The clean looking, good looking page may not always mean that's a well recorded EEG. Our OverSmart technicians try to always give this simple page with no any artifacts, not showing any abnormality, and then we say it's a normal. So it's not always you see that abnormality unless you do the EEG recording or you check the EEG with the standard filter settings and sensitivity. Also, not to change filters more often. If you are seeing lot of muscle activity, then it's okay. But try to make a habit that you see the underlying beautiful EEG waves underneath the artifacts. So like here, this man is looking all his begums beautifully under the artifacts. Similarly, bigger the better. So more the EEG recorded, I think more abnormality or more yield it will provide. So short EEG usually is to be avoided. At least 20 minutes of sleep, 20 minutes of awake record, 40 minutes total has to be done. And especially in pediatric age group where we are suspecting Salam spasm or West syndrome, I think at least 1 hour EEG recording has to be done. Again, patient's comfort is very important. When the patient is comfortable, then we can reduce the artifacts, the EMG and other artifacts. So patient has to be very comfortable. Another artifact is sampling or aliasing. When our sampling rate is not fast enough to record the fastest frequency, the aliasing artifact will result. This slide shows what is aliasing. When the pen or analog recording shows the beautiful sinusoidal wave, if it's not frequently sampled, if it's just 2.5 times, then you may get this waves which are not actual representative of this original waveform. When the sampling rate is fast, you are almost near to the original waveform. So the sampling or aliasing has to be checked. This is not in our hands. When we buy a machine, I think that time the sampling rate has to be, we should know, and it has to be at least twice the fastest frequency. Again, the same slide showing importance of fast frequency sampling and prevention of aliasing. Now moving on to artifacts, it's a unwanted potential which comes from either the patient, which is a physiological, either from the eye blinks, from the ECG or muscle contraction, or sometimes from outside the patient, which is from environment. It can be machine, electrical noise, or anything. How to identify? If the activity is limited to only single channel or the electrode, and it should be assumed as an artifact, rhythmic waves that occur simultaneously in unrelated head regions. So there are many artifacts. The electrode artifacts like pop, poor contact, movement, perspiration, salt breach, or movement. Environmental artifacts like 50-60 hertz ambient
electrical noise, intravenous drip, electrical noise from devices, mechanical noise from devices, muscle artifacts, EMG, glossokinetic, photomyogenic, photomyoclonic, cardiac like electrocardiographic or ECG, pacemaker, pulse, ballistocardiograph, or ocular like blink, eye flutter, lateral gaze, slow roving eye, lateral rectus, rapid eye, and electroretinogram. So these slides shows the cardiac artifact. Obviously, this is synchronous with the QRS complex. This is nothing but ECG artifact. Just make a note that this is the montage to the ipsilateral layer, referential montage to the ipsilateral. When FP1 is connected to A1, the potential is upward, means A1 is positive compared to FP1. Dr. Neeraj has yesterday told us about this polarity. So A1 is positive, and when C4A2 or F4A2, this wave is downward, means A2 is negative compared to F4. So A1 is positive, A2 is negative. So right, left ear is positive, right ear is negative. This is because cardiac vector which runs from right to left. So remember, this is very important. Another cardiac related artifact is the ECG channel shown here, and we see a run of slow waves in this channel and this channel. This is not exactly synchronous with the QRS complex, but it is happening immediately after that. It's called as pulse artifact. This is not directly the electrical interference from the EKG vector, but it is the movement of this C3 electrode, which is synchronous with the, or little happening with little delay with the QRS complex. And this little movement with each pulse, because this is near to one blood vessel, so with each pulse the electrode is moving little bit, and this giving rise to a slow artifact, and this is nothing but a pulse artifact. This is different from the EKG artifact. Another, this looks like a generalized pulse artifact. Here you can still see the ECG artifact, but otherwise it just looks like generalized slow. This is cardioballistogram. It is generalized pulse artifact with the each cardiac stroke volume or cardiac contraction, the body movement giving rise to this cardioballistogram. Another slide, 75-year male in coma, very regular happening, looks like EKG artifact. I have not shown purposefully the EKG channel, but this is not EKG artifact, because as I told you, A1 should be upwards and A2 should be downwards for that EKG artifact. Here everything is up, so this is periodic complex and not the EKG artifact. Electrode pop, sudden discharge from the electrode gives rise to this positive divergence, sometimes negative divergence also. It can be in the runs also, mimicking like a electrographic activity or electrographic seizure, but this is nothing but a electrode pop artifact. Here the channel is flat and now it becomes completely flat. This is because of the two electrodes are connected by switch. So this is, once they become equipotential, there is no waveform generated. This was very well explained by Dr. Neeraj yesterday. Moving on to muscle artifacts, not at all difficult. We know that this is the most common artifact. Usually the frontalis temporalis muscle will give rise to this muscle contraction or EMG artifact. And with tongue movement, you can still get a called as a glossokinetic artifact. So here the generalized slow rhythm is seen, maxima again frontally. As Dr. Siddharth explained yesterday, the eye movements will generate some potential, similarly tongue movements will generate potentials. Or he has asked us to remember that the cornea is positive compared to the retina. Here the tongue tip is negative compared to the base of the tongue, which is positive. So this dipole has to be remembered. Chewing artifact. Ocular artifacts, majority are already covered by Dr. Siddharth yesterday. This is blink, this is flutter-like, fast blink. This is lateral eye movements,
and just preceding the lateral eye movements is small spiky potential, that's a lateral rectus EMG artifact. This was also explained by Dr. Siddharth yesterday, the slow moving eye movements, slow roving eye movements, as he told us that whenever there is open window, eyes are looking to that side. So this is looking to the right, looking to left, looking to left, looking to right. This is photic drive. And this is again eye blink artifacts. This, with this photic stimulation, you see frontal artifact. This is photocell artifact or photoelectrical artifact. Some chemical reaction causes potential to generate because of the photic stimulation, and then this the artifact is generated. Once you stop the photic stimulation, this artifact will stop. Another potential, another artifact with photic stimulation is photomyogenic, where the eye blinks and the muscle around the eyes will give rise to this photomyogenic, sometimes photomyoclonic also the artifacts. This is another photic stimulation induced artifact, which is seen frontally like notch theta. It is continuous on the left side, and on the right side, once the right eye is covered, it is absent. This is ERG. Even the retina gives the potential which can be picked up in a frontal eye field. This again, eye movement artifact, the eyes are moving to the left. This is F7, T3. So it is beating with a jerk to the left. But what is happening on the right side? There's nothing on the right side. So only nystagmus, which is beating to the left, and no right eye movement is seen in right eye. The right eye is failing to adduct, and the left eye is abducting, having abduction nystagmus. So thank you for patiently listening. I have to answer many questions. There are many artifacts which I have included as quiz after Dr. Jayanti Mani talks on focal and generalized epilepsy. So I request Dr. Jayanti Mani to take over and start with her talk. Thank you.
Anand, are you still sharing your screen or?
No, I stopped.
Then I'm not able to yet.
You have all green button.
Yeah, so yeah. Is it on? Can you see it?
Yeah.
It's become really slow, I don't know why. Yeah, good evening, everyone. Firstly, thanks, Anand, for organizing this EEG course online. I think it's a good exercise to see what we are able to do online, you know, showing EEG waveforms and things. I think the three of you all have really covered quite a wide spectrum of things over the last 3 days. So if you can, if you have followed Neeraj's and then Siddharth's and then now Anand's talks, then identifying epileptiform abnormalities is going to be rather easy. So a lot of it may overlap with what has been already said. So, but I guess it doesn't matter for a recap. So I'm going to kind of randomly run through a few things along the way. And my focus is really going to be on epileptiform abnormalities on the EEG, both focal and generalized abnormalities. So when you start looking at an EEG page, the first thing you do is you look at the background. That's the background rhythms. So we look at the amplitude, the frequency, the distribution, that is the location of that rhythm and the field, and we judge what that is. And after that, you know, what you do is what hits you on the face, that is what jumps out of the background and you can see it very clearly. And these are what we call a transient. A transient is something that stands out of the background. Now, again, here the same principle applies. You're again looking at its amplitude, its frequency, and its location. And based on that, you try and classify what kind of a transient it is. And the other thing you do also is to look at something called slowing in the EEG, which is not so obvious. And often, you know, you have to kind of train your eye to start picking up this kind of slowing. And it's not very different again, like in any other waveform. Again, you're looking at its amplitude and its frequency and its location. And based on all of this, you try to make out as to whatever you're seeing on the EEG, each of these phenomena, are they physiological or are they artifactual? And if they are physiological, then are they cerebral or non-cerebral? And based on this, you and then if they are cerebral, are they like a physiological cerebral, like a sleep transient or something to that effect, or is it an epileptiform discharge? So basically, this is the way we look at an EEG. Now, when we look at epileptiform transients, because that's what I'm going to restrict myself, I repeat myself, this is something that stands out of the background. Now, depending on its frequency, we group them as a spike, a sharp wave, and a spike and a slow wave complex, or a slow wave. Now, as you can see here, when the duration is less than 70 milliseconds and it has a very sharp contour at the top, we call it a spike. If it is between 70 and 200, it is a sharp wave. And if it's longer than 200, it is a slow wave. But we also have something called a spike and a wave complex, which is also something which is usually typically seen in a lot of more of the generalized epilepsies. So these are the three different transient types that we look at. And as I said, we are looking at its duration, amplitude, and its frequency, whether it's coming in single or whether it's coming as runs. And when it comes as runs, that forms a rhythm. And that most important thing, of course, is whether that transient has any physiological field. And this is something Neeraj had explained to us yesterday. A little more about a transient. What you want to decide is whether it's an epileptic transient or a non-epileptic transient. So there are some features of the transient itself that will tell you whether this is likely to be epileptic or not. So I've shown you two waveforms here. The one on the top is what is more likely to be an epileptic transient, and the one below is more likely to be a non-epileptic transient. So as you can see, this has an asymmetric contour, and the descending limb often goes, overshoots and goes below the baseline, and you often have an aftergoing slow wave, and this waveform disturbs the baseline. So this is classic of an epileptic transient, and usually the epileptic transient has a field. Now, this is not to say that non-epileptic transients don't have a field. Sometimes non-epileptic transients can disturb the baseline. For example, you take a K complex. In fact, it is all of these. It's asymmetric. It often has a descending limb that goes below the baseline. There is an aftergoing slow wave. And it has a field as well. But this is not epileptic. So there are always going to be caveats. But in general, these kind of features, if many of them are present, it's more likely to be a epileptic versus a non-epileptic transient. So with this background, now we are going to look at focal transients on a scalp EEG. So when we look at a focal transient and in focal epilepsy, our main purpose is to localize it. First, of course, we want to determine is it epileptic or not, which we have already discussed. And then the next thing we want to do is decide whether it's epileptic and where is it located. Now, what are the factors that affect that? There are various. We have already discussed this. Depending on the source of that electrical discharge, what is the volume conduction around that area, the brain, skull, and the geometry? What are the different interfaces? And also how we are recording the whole thing. What kind of montage we are using, what kind of inter-electrode distances there are. All of this is going to influence the morphology of that spike. And we already saw this yesterday, but I'm just going to repeat myself that there are certain principles by which we try to localize the focal transient. So on a bipolar montage, we've already seen that it is based on the phase reversal. And on a referential montage, it's based on the amplitude of the waveform. But most importantly, apart from all this, there has to be a physiological field. Now, there are again exceptions, because when you have a bipolar montage and there is no phase reversal, that happens at the end of the chain. And here, like for example, an occipital spike, often you don't see a phase reversal, but it can still be a focal discharge. Similarly, in case of a referential montage, you can sometimes see a phase reversal, and that is either because of a technical issue that you are using a wrong reference, or another concept of what is called a tangential dipole, which we will see along the way as it has not yet been covered. So as I said, there has to be a, whatever the waveform, there has to be a field, and that's very important in making our localizations. So with all this in mind, we're going to see some more examples. So here again is an example of a waveform. Now this is standing out of the background and there is an after going slow wave. It's not very large in amplitude, but if you can see the duration, it's something between 70 and 200, so somewhere between a spike and a sharp wave, and it has got a nice field. So this is an example of a focal sharp wave. The same sharp wave, when the person got drowsier, and this is typical of what happens in sleep. Sorry, Dr. Bhatt is calling me, I don't know why. So you can see a waveform that is much larger in amplitude. It still has the same location that there is a phase reversal. This is a bipolar montage. And as you can see, it's phase reversing at T2, but it has a much wider field now. So this is what happens typically in sleep, that waveforms which are focal become more wider in field. In fact, you can also see it along the parasagittal chain. So not only has it spread anteroposteriorly, but also laterally, and it has a much wider field in sleep. But this is still a focal sharp wave. Now, this is another location. Now, this is also a temporal sharp wave. But as you can see, it is actually located more posteriorly. That's at the T6 electrode, and it is occurring in runs. So this is different temporal sharp wave compared to what we saw earlier. Now, what about this? So this one here is a very small looking transient. It's less than 50 microvolts. It does have a field, but if you can see, it's very symmetric. It doesn't have an asymmetric contour. It doesn't cross the baseline on here, and it does not disturb the baseline either. So this looks more like a benign transient. That's a BETS. Benign epileptic transient to sleep. On the other hand, here, this one is a sharper looking, rather larger amplitude, and it has a after going slow, and there is a field that is making a lot of sense. So this is actually a epileptic form sharp wave. So that's how you differentiate. In the same page, you can see that there are two different waveforms, and one is different from the other. One is benign and the other is likely to be epileptic. And this later, you're also seeing a slow wave in the same area. This is typical of usually what you see in symptomatic focal epilepsies, that there is also independent slowing apart from what you see associated with the spike. That tells you that there may be some focal dysfunction in that area. Now, what about this? So here you're seeing a spike wave and then there's an after going slow. Now, if you notice, there is a small field here, but it is not very striking, but you can see that there is a field. Now, there is no phase reversal because probably it is, you know, very anterior, but you can see a field that is better located in the central region. So this looks more like a frontocentral sharp wave rather than a frontotemporal sharp wave. And interestingly, this lady had a normal MRI and she went on to have a SEEG, and she had these spikes coming from her Heschel's gyrus. So this is an example of how you can have spikes need not necessarily coming from, you know, the mesial temporal lobe. They could be anywhere, even in the operculum or in the insula, and all of these can give you similar looking spikes in the same frontotemporal region. Now we will look at benign focal epilepsies with the idea of, it gives, helps us illustrate two phenomena. One is the tangential dipole that you see in benign Rolandic epilepsy, and also the end of chain phenomenon that you see with occipital epilepsies. Now, what is classic about benign focal epilepsies on their EEG is that they always have a normal background. So So there are no background abnormalities in the EEG, and it's only the classical looking spike waveforms that you see in these conditions. As against that, when you have symptomatic focal epilepsies, as I just showed you in that earlier slide, that apart from the spikes, you also have slowing of various durations, which may be intermittent, it may be continuous, and that may point out to you that there is something structural in addition to the epileptiform discharges. So we come to benign childhood epilepsy with centrotemporal spikes. I'm going to stick to the EEG features. We are all aware it occurs in the late part of the first decade with these focal seizures that happen in sleep involving the face and the arm. And the child may often wake up, drooling and half aware of the seizures. So these are on the EEG. This is the location. These are Rolandic epilepsy. So the spikes or the epileptogenicity is located at the bottom of the Rolandic sulcus in the frontal operculum. Now, because of this location, you get a typical waveform and a typical appearance of a tangential dipole. So as I already told you, the background is normal and the spikes are centrotemporal. Because of this location, they are either seen in the center. Is my pointer visible?
No, madam.
Can you see my pointer now?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, so because of this, this is the area where the spikes originate. So you can see that it will distribute itself over the temporal region and the central region. And that what is very, very typical of all these all these benign epilepsies is the marked activation of these discharges by sleep. So let us see a few. So this is the appearance of this waveform, as you can see it here, the typical BFED, the benign focal epileptiform discharge, which is a triphasic discharge. There's an initial positivity, which may or may not be there every time. It's not there in this case. And then you have this very prominent negativity that then goes down below the baseline. And then there is aftergoing, again, another positivity, which is much slower. So this is the triphasic morphology. And you get because of the orientation of the dipole, I'm sorry that these pictures are not very visible. I don't know if you can still notice how do I move the location of the screen? Is this okay? So now here, because it is located in this region, the dipole tends to be tangential to the surface rather than a radial dipole that you normally see. So this is the orientation of the dipole, because of which you will see I can show it over here. So there is a phase reversal, which is a negative phase reversal over here. And if you notice over here, the entire orientation is upward, which is you don't see the end of chain phenomenon happening here. So there's actually a positive phase reversal at this end. So you see a positivity in the frontal region and a negativity in the centrotemporal region. So there are two phase reversals happening on a bipolar montage. So as I said, you often these spikes tend to be bilateral, sometimes synchronous, sometimes asynchronous. They may keep switching sides, and they get markedly activated in sleep. So this is one example. You can see this is a person who's awake. This is he's 11-year-old boy. And then, as he gets drowsy, you start seeing these small little transients. You're not even sure whether this is anything significant. And then as he falls into deeper sleep, can you see this, what I'm pointing out? Here, these spikes. I'm not sure if y'all can visualize my arrow, but there are these sharp transients with a phase reversal at C4 that you're noticing. It's at the second, and probably on 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, at the 9th second. Now, as you progress further into sleep, you're seeing these on the left side now, and as they into deeper sleep, you can see how these typical morphology of the BFEDs with runs. So you can see some more runs over here, Whereas with hyperventilation, these don't get activated. And again, you can see another example of a double phase reversal with the frontal positivity and a centrotemporal negativity. So this is a typical example of so I don't know if you can appreciate that frontal positivity and the centrotemporal negativity. And this is the same thing on an average montage, where you can see that this is a negative phase reversal at C4, and there is a positive phase reversal at FP2. So we go to frontal lobe spikes and sharp waves. Now the frontal lobe is quite unique because it has a very large areas which are not accessible to the surface. So you don't see most of the discharges. So it's not surprising that most frontal lobe epilepsies, you don't get anything interictally. Sometimes it can be multifocal and sometimes bilateral and sometimes even contralateral, because as Neeraj had told you, if it's a mesial frontal spike, sometimes you may see it projecting on the opposite hemisphere. So interestingly, there was a series that looked at simultaneous intracranial scalp EEG in frontal lobe epilepsies, and only 14% of the spikes that were seen on intracranial EEG could be seen on the scalp. And most of these were actually coming from the dorsolateral cortex. So all this area, that area in red that you have marked, you can't see spikes coming from this area at all. So these are some examples of frontal spikes. Again, this is a end of chain phenomenon. So you don't see a you don't see a phase reversal. But if you had connected this as a circumferential montage, you would have seen a phase reversal probably between FP1 and FP2. Most likely it would have been at FP2. So these are frontal spikes. And this is another patient who had this depth of sulcus dysplasia. And you can see these rhythmic discharges that look frontocentral in distribution, mainly at F4. You can see a little phase reversal. And if you notice, these are these very, very tiny spikes. These are typical of cortical dysplasia, and they occur in runs. So this is very classical appearance of what you see in focal cortical dysplasia. The other phenomenon that you must be aware is what is called secondary bilateral synchrony in frontal lobe epilepsies. So you may be, what will strike you are these generalized discharges, and you will think that this is a primary generalized epilepsy. But if you notice here that you're actually seeing a run of spikes that, you know, kind of build up and then suddenly change in morphology, and they become synchronized and bilateral. So this is something you see in focal epilepsies and from the frontal lobe, that you can have generalized discharges. In the occipital, I'm going to use one classic example of a benign occipital epilepsy of the gastro type, which occurs slightly older. The younger, even younger age group, this is a peneotopolis type of benign focal epilepsy from the occipital lobe. So here, you know, these occur around 8 years of age. The clinical phenomena are important. Many times the seizures may not be very, very obvious. They just have visual hallucinations or just blindness. There may be some eye deviation, and often they have headaches. And in fact, they also have migraines. So you may miss the condition if the motor convulsions are not very clearly haven't occurred. So the important EEG features are the occipital spikes and the fixation of sensitivity. So what do we mean by that? So this is a 6-year-old girl. Again, when she's awake, you can see the nice eye blinks, and there is some intermittent slowing that you can see in the occipital lobe. And then when she gets drowsy, if you can notice, there is a very similarity between the morphology you saw of the B-fed in the rolandic region and the one you're seeing here. The morphology looks similar, it's just that the distribution is different. And again, for the same reason, you're just seeing there is no phase reversal, though this is a bipolar montage, and this is because of the end of chain phenomenon. Now, the other feature you get is fixation of sensitivity. And what we mean by that is the minute the child closes her eyes, you see this runs of irregular discharges, which disappear when the eyes are opened. So again, when the eyes are blinking and open, it's gone away. Again, when the eyes are closed, you get these discharges. And these are called fixation of sensitivity, which is very classical of gastro type of benign focal epilepsies. Now, this is again the same thing. Now, interestingly, when you look at how are scalp EEGs, interictal discharges distributed? This is what you see in temporal lobe epilepsies. You can see it in, you know, bilateral temporal, and you can sometimes see it also in the parietal lobe. On the other hand, when you have a parietal lobe epilepsy, these spikes tend to be very small, and often they are distributed very widely. Very few of them are in the parietal lobe. In fact, you see a lot of them that get projected to the frontal, to the temporal, or even to the occipital, or sometimes to the central regions. And that's why, if you notice, we very rarely, you know, are really identifying parietal spikes, because firstly, they're very small, and because of the extreme connectivity, you see them projecting to other regions. And this is how the frontal spikes typically are projecting, in FP1, FP2, and in the F7, F8, and these regions, that's where you see the frontal spikes. So that's so much about focal epilepsies. Now quickly, I'll just run through some generalized epilepsies. Now here in this situation, the localization is not important. It's about recognizing patterns. So what are the patterns we see in generalized epilepsies? So 3 hertz spike wave. We also see the slow spike wave, which I'm not going to allude to today because these are all symptomatic generalized, and I'm going to leave it for the pediatrician because most of these syndromes occur in childhood. Then we also have the fast spike wave, that is more than 3 hertz, a polyspike wave, and the photoparoxysmal response. So these are all the characteristic aspects of generalized EEG patterns. So what are these waveforms? So you have the 3 hertz spike wave, that's a spike and a wave occurring in a very monomorphic way, 3 times a second. The same thing when it gets much slower, you call it a slow spike wave, when it's 2 to 2.5. A fast is anything beyond 4 and above, and this is what we call a polyspike wave. Sometimes you may only get polyspikes as well without the wave. That's also possible. And we use several activation methods because to diagnose the generalized epilepsies, it's really about documenting these patterns. And sometimes you don't see it on a routine EEG. So you use various activation methods to demonstrate it. For example, the hyperventilation is classically what we use in childhood absences, whereas photic stimulation you may use in JME, and sleep deprivation is useful in most of these. Not the way it is useful in focal epilepsies, but still you do see some patterns getting identified even in idiopathic generalized epilepsies. So this is the classic 3 hertz spike wave. And often you will notice that when it starts off, it may be a little faster. And as time goes by, it will slow down. So this, though we say it's 3 hertz and uniform, it's often not exactly uniform, and it may slightly slow down as the waveforms progress. And the duration can vary anything between like 1 second to, you know, 3 to 10 seconds as well. So here you are seeing again that it's much faster at the beginning. You can in fact see 4 hertz. And then as you move ahead, it's about 2.5 to 3 hertz. So this is seen on hyperventilation. So I've marked it for you, just showing 4 and 3. And you can see also that initially the spike tends to be buried, and then it gets more obvious as the waveform evolves. So this is an example of a fast spike wave, because as you can see, there's, when you count, it's 4 hertz, and it remains 4 hertz throughout this discharge, for most of the discharge at least. And this is a fast spike wave. This you see typically in the IGEs, like the JMEs and JAEs as well. This is a polyspike wave discharge. This is a fragmented spike wave. Not always that you see a nice waveform, especially in sleep. A lot of these waveforms tend to get fragmented. Again, this can be in sleep. As you can see, there is hardly any eye blinks or muscle activity, so the person is becoming drowsy, and the typical monomorphic waveforms get disintegrated into something that looks more irregular. So the other thing we should remember is that you can get some focal discharges in patients with idiopathic generalized epilepsy as well. So here is an example how you can see that this is a generalized discharge. But on another page, we had this discharge, which looked focal on the left side in the central region. And here again, you see a discharge which is on the Right. So it can flip sides. So just because you see focal discharges, this doesn't become a focal to generalized epilepsy. It still remains an idiopathic generalized epilepsy. So there are various syndromes, and it's not really important to, and many times it's not the appearance on the EEG alone that helps you decide which syndrome it is. The clinical spectrum is also important, the age of onset, the kind of seizures they're having, the kind of activation procedures that triggers them. So as you can see, if you take this 2.5 hertz, you can have these also in a childhood absence up to 18%. In juvenile absence up to 21%, and in GME much less often, 3%. The typical 2.5 to 3.5 hertz, you see it in absence 75%, in GME 60%, and in JAE up to 55%. Now, as you can see, the atypical fast ones in JAE is, that's the juvenile absence, you can see it as high as 83%. So I'm going to quickly show you, do I have some time to show a video?
Yes, madam, go ahead.
So this is an example. I'm straight going to hit the can you see the screen now?
Yes.
So this is a girl who's
not the video.
You're not seeing the video?
No.
How do I get that to?
I think what you will have to do is you will have to first stop sharing the screen. And had you checked the optimizer screen for video clip?
No, I haven't done that.
Yeah, so you'll have to do that. So you can stop sharing your screen now.
Okay.
And just click the green button, share screen.
Okay.
Yeah, so on your window, like you'll get a small white screen. So on the left hand side below corner, you have two options.
Yeah, okay.
So you select optimize the screen for video clip.
Yeah, it's shared both computer sound and that, so that's fine. So now I start, can you see it now?
Yes, we can see the window of the video.
Okay, great. So sorry for taking the time. So I will... is the video playing?
Also, ma'am, when you play the video, your voice will not be heard.
I see. Okay.
No, video is not seen. It's just black window.
Why I didn't do it? Stop share. Okay. Nahi.
You haven't played the video yet.
So only when I play it, it'll show?
60. 61.
Oh, it's only audio.
We still can't see your video.
So do I go back and check it?
But we can make out the video. It's absence.
You can make out? Okay, if you're fine with it, then we just go on because I don't want to. So optimized clip for video sharing is checked. And now I'm sharing again. If it's not playing, we just move on.
Remember red color? Remember
no, it's video still, not seen.
The video is not playing. We can hear the audio, but we can't see the video.
Okay, let's just leave it then. I think we just
can see the EEG running behind the video, but not the video.
Oh, really? Okay. Fine. That's fine because I wanted to show the mouth automatisms and all that you can see sometimes in an absence. But that's fine. I will go on to the PPT back. So can you now see my screen?
Yes.
Yeah, so now we go on to the other last aspect of this, that is the photoparoxysmal response. And as you all we discussed yesterday, there are various degrees of photoparoxysmal responses that you can get. So this is the photomyogenic response, which is a non-epileptic, it's an artifactual response, that is myogenic potentials, which Anand just talked about. And these do not have an epileptogenic significance. As against that, you can have various degrees of photoparoxysmal responses. And this you can see here that the photic signal is seen in the bottom. Is this all visible? Hello?
Blurred, but visible. The slide is visible.
My arrow?
Arrow is visible.
So I want to point, not clear, is it? Oh God, okay. Anyway, so this is showing a rhythm in the back of the head that is time locked with the EEG, and it's stopping with the photic drive, the photic stimulus. So this is one type of photo, the milder version of the photoparoxysmal response, which is time locked and posterior head region. I'm sorry that you can't see it well. This is a more irregular generalized response at the bottom, which does not last till the end of the stimulus. So that's another milder version. And this is a more severe version of the photoparoxysmal response, where you're seeing an epileptic pattern that is triggered by the photic stimulus, but it outlasts the stimulus. And this is the one most likely to be associated with epilepsy. Now, an abnormal photoparoxysmal response is particularly predictive of epileptogenicity if there is the generalized spike wave that we saw, which was not time-locked, it outlasts the stimulus, and if there are clinical symptoms associated with it. So we'll skip this now. That what I wanted to emphasize is that while 70 to 80% of people with the photoparoxysmal response have epilepsy, there is a good 20% who just have PPR and does not imply that they always have epilepsy. And one in 4,000 people in the general population can have a photoparoxysmal response without epilepsy. So the syndromes that are associated with the photoparoxysmal response, again, with JME, it's about 30 to 35%. It can be seen occasionally in absence epilepsies as well, and much less in JAE, that's the juvenile absence. It's also seen in a lot of progressive myoclonic epilepsies like the Lafora body, the NCL, the Unverrich-Lundberg, and the Murph syndromes. So all of these, usually when you see a photoparoxysmal response in a patient with a generalized tonic-clonic seizure, it indicates a genetically determined epilepsy. But there is also a large proportion of focal epilepsies in the occipital region that can also trigger a photoparoxysmal response. So we need to remember that. And finally, you know, we also need to be aware of ictal rhythms that you can see in a routine EEG. Sometimes you may be triggering off a seizure. So how do you recognize them? So this is when you have a rhythm that evolves. So it has to evolve in amplitude, it has to evolve in frequency, and it also has to evolve in its distribution. And at least two of the three things have to evolve before you can call it a ictal rhythm. And of course, if there's an associated clinical symptom, that helps the best. But sometimes you also can have non-convulsive seizures. And these, especially in the setting of an ICU, the portable EEGs, sometimes you may have to diagnose it in an obstructed patient. So here you're seeing this evolving rhythm. And this patient had a cortical dysplasia. Often this kind of pattern earlier used to be said that temporal ictal pattern, theta rhythms, and it's MTS. But I wanted to emphasize that many times there is no structural, you know, there's no one-to-one etiological correlation. It just tells you that this is most likely a mesial temporal rhythm, and it can be a dysplasia, it can be MTS, it can be any of these. So here it is evolving further in amplitude and frequency at that's 10 seconds post, and that's very classical ictal rhythm that you can see in the mesial temporal region. So it's evolving further. Then you also have periodic discharges. And these are rhythms that don't evolve. They keep recurring at the same pattern. And these are what we call pleds. Now, sometimes these pleds can be epileptic, but sometimes they may not. And the one way to know that is when you look at their morphology. So you saw this one, it's a single transient that keeps repeating itself. This type of one is less likely to be evolving into an ictal pattern. So here, on the other hand, this has a complex morphology, and you can see some faster rhythms within it. These are temporal pleds, that the other one was occipital. And this is when you change the paper speed, you can see that there is some variability in the frequency. This may suggest that it may evolve into something ictal. And then these are what are called pleds plus. And these are the ones which are notorious to evolve into seizures. Now, this is a ictal rhythm, and you can see here that there are some pled-like discharges, but the seizure is coming on the opposite side. So this was a lady with NMD encephalitis who was in coma and was having these kind of non-convulsive seizures. So I'm going to skip this, and I think I will end here. So Anand, I'm done.
I think, okay, if you have more slides to continue as a part of quiz, I think.
Yeah, but if you want to show yours and then we can take it after that, because.
Because otherwise we have to change the screen. So better you continue.
Okay, okay. I have about three or four, so I will quickly run them. So what is this? The problem is to get an answer is going to be tough on these, but what is this likely to be? You're seeing a temporal sharp wave. So this, if you look at the morphology and the background, it doesn't distort the background. So this is a benign epileptic transient of sleep. Now, you have to be careful, because I think though I've called it a benign epileptic transient, I am going to be a little more wary before I say this, actually, because if you notice, it is it's 15 microvolts per millimeter. So it's quite high in amplitude. So sometimes, and there is a small field. So though there is no aftergoing slow and it has a very restricted location, I'm going to say that I need to see more discharges before I assume that this is a benign epileptic transient. So here, on the other hand, is a much more clear-cut spike, which has a nice field. It is showing a phase reversal at T4 and also at C4, P4. It's more looking like a centrotemporal spike. So, and there is also the clear-cut after going slow wave that you see at the end of it. So here, there is no doubt, whereas the other one, I had my doubts. So what I wanted to say is sometimes just looking at one wave may not help you make a decision. So you want to see more pages of the EEG before you make a final impression on what that particular waveform is. So this is about an eight-year-old boy, and he was playing football, and then he was knocked by his playmate. So we don't know what happened first. They kind of collided and he fell down and he passed out, and he had some uprolling of eyes, and he actually was incontinent as well. And then he was brought to thinking that it could be an epileptic seizure. So he had no other previous issues, though they did report that he was a little hyperactive and distracted while in class. But his perinatal history and all was all normal. So based on that, for this paroxysmal event, we had done this EEG. So what is this? So you have to identify this paroxysm. Is it a polyspike wave? Is it a 3 hertz spike wave? Is it a hyperventilation response? Or is it a photoparoxysmal response? Or is it hypnagogic hypersynchrony? Yeah, so it is in fact hypnagogic hypersynchrony, and as you can see, it can look very, sometimes the ongoing rhythms that are overlapping it can appear like spikes, and this can look like a spike in wave rhythm, but in fact, it is actually a normal variant as the child is falling asleep. So what this boy had, in fact, was a vasovagal episode, and that was hypnagogic hypersynchrony, and this is not epileptiform. Now, this is a 12-year-old girl. Now, again, she also had fainted during an outdoor drill in school, and she used to keep having these episodes of dizziness and occipital headache for the last 6 months, and sometimes she would even have vomiting with these episodes. So it's one such thing she had, and she had fainted in the school. So this is her EEG. As she's getting drowsy, you can see this rhythm. So what is this? What is your diagnosis? Is this a vertebrobasilar migraine that she's having? Is it a benign occipital epilepsy? You think this is a posterior cerebral SOL and that's why you're having these discharges? Or is this a vasovagal syncope? So I guess you'll have all marked your answers. So what you're noticing here, this is in fact a vasovagal syncope, and what you're noticing, these are all the posterior slow waves of youth that you can appreciate that even within this discharge, these slow waves, you can see the overriding faster rhythms within it. So in fact, these are physiological posterior slow waves of youth. and these are not epileptic. Now, what are these? So what I'm pointing out are these little rhythms. The person is drowsy. The person is drowsy and there is no eye blinks. And you're seeing these positively. You can see these positively charged, oriented sharp waves. And they're coming in runs. So positive, and they are located in the occipital region. So positive occipital sharp transients in sleep. So these are, yeah. So these are again normal variants. And this is not an occipital spike. So these, what is this? So these are spikes that you can see. Again, if you look at the, you have to look at the sensitivity here. It's 5 microvolts per millimeter as against that previous one. And you can see that it has a very wide field, though there is a phase reversal. So these are very small amplitude and you don't have any after going slow. So these are small, sharp spikes or again, benign epileptiform transients of sleep. And this one yesterday, we were shown. So over here.
Wicket.
Yeah, so this is a wicket again, because there is, it's not evolving and it has a nice arciform top, unlike a epileptiform discharge, and it so this is a wicket rhythm. These of course are phantom spike wave, which yesterday Siddharth spoke about. And what about this? Is this a frontal sharp wave? Or is it an artifact? So this is in fact an artifact because it has absolutely no field. And in fact, the whole baseline has deflected. So it's some kind of an electrode artifact, and it's not a, because it doesn't have any field. What about this? You're seeing these rhythmic discharges. Is this an absence? Because it's about 3.5 hertz. So actually this is not, because the field is, doesn't have a physiological field, right? It's falling off very quickly and you don't see any spikes within it. And it's, so it's actually an ocular flutter, eye flutter. So something like this, you also need to be having a good technologist who will immediately look at the patient and see what is happening. So some of these you do need to have that kind of information to be sure, but then it should raise a red flag because of the abrupt fall off of the discharge without a proper field. So we stop here, Anand?
Yeah, I can continue mine.
Yeah, I'll stop sharing my screen.
Am I audible now?
Yes.
Okay. So whatever we have learned, I'm just taking a revision. I know you were not able to answer my questions, but you can still, in your mind, give an answer. So this is straightforward, eye blink artifacts. This one, again, eye flutter with some EMG artifact here. And large eye blink artifact here. Again, the EMG artifact here. Now, so as the ECG channel is shown, these potentials are synchronous with this. So it is likely EKG artifacts. Very regular, almost all electrodes are picking this. So this
regularly appearing, the morphology is exactly similar, it is unlikely physiological. So it is external artifacts or EKG artifacts. This one again, muscle or chewing artifact. This one, you can see these slow movement, slow waves here. So is it a slow eye movements or something else? Yesterday, Dr. Siddhartha very well explained that it has to be out of phase. So if this is, this window is open, means the eyes are looking to the left. And at the same time, here the window should not be open for the lateral eye movements. Here both are in phase, so it is more like the sweat artifact than not the lateral eye movements or roving eye, slow eye movements. This is again a glossokinetic artifact, widely spread, maximum frontally. And if you ask patient to say la la la, or if she's saying something, then it is likely to be visible on as a glossokinetic artifact. Most of the times it is associated with some muscle movements or muscle artifacts also. There were many questions regarding how to differentiate between the EKG artifact and the periodic complexes. So what do you think? As I said, the cardiac vector is from right to left. The A1 is positive, A2 is negative. So here the all potentials, all the electrodes connected to ipsilateral ear or A1 is upgoing, while electrodes connected to the right ear are downgoing. Okay, so this is upgoing, this is downgoing, this is EKG artifact. Sometimes if you don't see any EEG background activity and only see this, then your problem comes whether it's a hypoxia related periodic complexes, which can happen at this frequency of 1 hertz, or is this a EKG artifact only and electrocerebral silence, or it's a patient of brain death. So here it is electrocerebral silence or EKG artifact. Here the eye blink artifact is seen, but what is odd, you see it on the left side, but you don't see it on the right side. Okay, so this is, there is no eye on the right side, or it's a glass eye or artificial eye on the right side. This is T5. This is coinciding with this photic stimulation, but here could be photo cell artifact, but here the notch filter is on, means the, it is a poor impedance which is picking up external electrical interference and also the picking up the photic artifact. So this is just poor electrode application of T5, which is giving rise to this kind of abnormality. This is slide 1. Apart from some eye blink artifacts, a good alpha rhythm, everything looks normal. And this is slide 2 of the same patient. Patient's eyes are open, and now you can see a artifact from, what is the reason behind this artifact? It is telephone ring. This is the last slide. So you can see the eye blink artifacts in frontal channels, FP1 A1, FP2 A2. But there is something odd which is made by stars. Same eye blink artifact is seen in O1 A1 channel. There is no business to be seen it here in occipital channel. It has to be seen here and here. So what is the reason behind this
artifact. The only clue I can give it, this is artifact and not the physiology.
Wrongly collected electrode.
Now, I've finished all my quiz slides. There are many questions. You can take the photograph. So there are many questions.
They want me to explain.
Be uploaded
explain.
On YouTube later. Yes.
Tangential dipole again.
Yeah, we already discussed many. I think it's difficult to teach again. But I'll just go through few questions which we can answer. I made many questions. I have typed the answer, so please go through it. How to differentiate between fixation of sensitivity and eye closure sensitivity?
Yeah, so actually these are all very technical aspects of photic. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
So, you know, the fixation off is typically you can use Fresnel's lenses so that you don't have, you're not focusing on anything. The other way you can do it is have a white screen on the ceiling so that the person is not looking at anything. So these are two ways to get fixation off is one. Then the other eye closure is very simple. Then the other way they do it is photosensitivity is to put the person in a dark room. So these are all very many, like these are all the technical ways in which, and there is some differences. People have analyzed all of this in different syndromes, you know, so, but the typical way we do photic is of course with photic stimulation, and eye closure sensitivity is something which you can easily document in the, routine OPD, I mean, in the OPD EEGs. And Fresnel's lenses, if you have, then that's all usually done in special labs that they use a glasses like that to get the fixation off. Now, regarding this, explaining this tangential dipole again, you know, it is something I could do, but I would need much more time. So maybe we can have another session, Anand. I don't know whether I can, you know, redo it here. I do have separate slides which that I thought in the interest of time, I just kind of touched upon it. So if that's all right, they can email me and then I can.
Yeah. What is the fragmentation of distance? I think that also you have covered.
Yeah, so fragmentation means instead of having a nice morphology like a 3 hertz spike or a 4 hertz spike wave, they all break up and then the spike and the wave don't follow in the nice format that they should and they just get broken up. So that's what is a fragmented spike wave. And I had an example of that as well, I think. You want me to show it again? I'll look for it. So this is a, have you logged out? Share screen.
Sorry, I can't.
Should I try I and share?
Yeah, you can. I have stopped sharing my screen. So you can share.
Yeah, so I'm trying to do that and yeah. Can you see it?
Not yet.
I don't know why. Do I have to, is it seen now?
Yeah, now we can see.
Yeah, so.
Yes, it's coming up.
You'll have to do a slideshow, ma'am.
Yeah, that's what I did. And I'm putting it on slideshow. In fact, it's not seen. So now I'm making it into, now it's seen,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So this is a typical 3 hertz spike wave. This is the fast spike wave. This is a poly spike wave. But if you see here, the same patient, instead of having a nice spike wave, it's all gotten disorganized. So this is what we mean by a fragmented spike wave. Any other questions that?
I think.
Anand, anything else?
Like, not much. The yesterday's and today's talk will be uploaded on YouTube. So once it is uploaded, we'll let you know. Maybe by tomorrow evening, after the last session, I will be able to tell you. So thank you once again, all the participants. Thank you, Dr. Jayanti Mani, madam.
Thank you so much, Anand. Great. Well done. Nice. I'm sorry if anyone wants to email me for anything, jayanti.mani@gmail.com.
And sir, these questions also which were there, I will anyway save them and send you all a file.
Sure.
In case if you want to take it up tomorrow or whenever, you have that for your reference then.
Thank you.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.